not leave alone the owner of that beautiful Arnico house. Think about how much money it would cost to preserve that house. So if you want to preserve Arnico, you need to support it. But if there is no support, instead of Arnico, there would be Art Pouvreau. This is another question. You see these sharp contrasts walking around and you wonder why. The answer is this. These two families were living on their salary until remittances appeared. Now the family to the right remembered that they have a relative in Miami who can send them money. A moment ago you learned that the average salary in Cuba is about $20 a month. Okay, suppose that relative in Miami is in capacity to send $100 a month. He would be sending 5 monthly salaries in one blow. And immediately the difference between the neighbors is 1 to 5. And the people to the right, they can take care of the house, the others cannot. So the urban expression is this. Our kitchen. Second chance, money talks. And And third, if we do not reduce the gap between Havana and the rest, shanty towns will continue, because migration will continue. And finally, the city, Havana, the last virgin city, no urban renewal, no sprawl, no drugs, no guns, no street gangs, no racial and ethnic conflicts. This is a very peaceful and quiet city, but decaying. Decay moves people to react in two ways. One group of people, including me, defend the idea that we should preserve the city we have, because this is the kind of city other people lost and they would like to recover. But at the same time, other people, impressed by the big dilapidation, they say the best we can do is to bulldoze entire areas to build their modern buildings. That's why, when we see these two options, I invite people to share with me what I consider a wise reflection that will help us to understand. So please pay attention. The human being is the only animal that stumbles twice on the same stone. If you want a good example of this, see how many times people marry.
Now would be a worker in the sun. But this is a question. Many people changing of the culture.
Sadly, I'm not convinced about that. I think that people are not prepared for that. We are not prepared. I mean, think about it. In the early 1990s, there was a small opening for foreign capital. And the foreign developers were seeing them as saviors. Oh, they come to help. They come to make money. But because of this, because of our ignorance in those aspects, many of them took advantage of that. And many of them took the big bite because, for example, some investments were done, practically paying nothing for the land or other regulations. I know a case of a hotel that the land was given by square meters and not by lots. So it's ignorance. Okay, but when you are very pressed in the bottom of a crisis, you do not discriminate very well. But in the case of this scenario in which you leave the embargo and the day after the big ones come, it's not tens of millions or hundreds of millions, billions of dollars coming at the same time. I call that a tsunami. It will be a tsunami. And I think we are not prepared for that. Yes.
Would the government give the same kind of projections for the future of the government line that you have given us today?
Well, some people think like me. I can assure you there are options. Some people are blurred by other models. Some people say, China, that's the way. Look at them. They were nothing and now sending a rocket to the moon. China is China. Cuba is Cuba. So when people say this, I recall an anecdote from the 1920s, when the man who ordered the construction of the Capitol was the president. It is said that in one reception, he addressed one senator that, by the way, was very well known by his witty sense of humor. And then he addressed the senator, Ferrara was the name of the man, and he said, Ferrara, I'm gonna turn Cuba into the Switzerland of the Americas. Mr. Ferrara, without moving a muscle of the face, answered, yes, Mr. President, and where are the Swiss? You want to make a... So many Cubans in the U.S. think that what we need to do is to Americanize the island. Okay, we need to bring the American. So it's a different culture. It's different. Okay? So people are confusing times, and the times of crisis can be compared for the moment when you're hungry, when you say, I'm very hungry, give me something to eat. You don't say, give me this or that, give me something. And look at people now, pressed by the long-lasting crisis and the side effects that are now coming to the surface, like this disparity, like this dual currency that is creating the to have and have not and this. And many people would like to see the light at the end of the tunnel, but they don't stop to think, what should be the answer? We're clear about that we need to leave behind that model that doesn't work anymore, but where are we going from now? This way, that way, this way? That's the big challenge is that. How clear? If we are going to be illuminated or not. Yes.
Who is it that ultimately makes the decision about restoration or destruction?
In North Havana?
Yeah.
No, you know, they are autonomous. They have total autonomy. The corporation in charge is very powerful. And this is one of the good advantages that they created. They are self-sufficient. And you say, you see, if you make your money, you make their decisions. They make their own money, they make their own decisions. Let me compare this. In North Havana, you have a population of 60,000 people. The planning office for the restoration of all Havana includes 35 professionals. And the rest of the city, 2 million people, has 54. Understand? Just, I made recently a presentation for the Physical Planning Institute, and I said, divide 54 by 50 municipalities, you have 3.6 professionals per municipality. What do you can do? Nothing. Play chess. salary in one day. You make 20 salaries in one month. That is a part. That today, as you saw, between neighbors, in the neighborhood, you and your neighbor, think about it. Your neighbor has better standards than you just because you have somebody out of there sending money. And he does the work. And you work very hard. You cannot go beyond. But he is, has a very large life to income. This is detrimental for this society.
One of the impressions that I've got, I'm sure others, as we've been moving around the island, is that so many places could be look so much better with just the paint, you know, just the coat of paint. And you put the building material prices up there to show how expensive everything is compared to monthly salary. Has the government ever made an effort to provide a can of paint to a family or, you know, some building materials just like they do the staples of other things, just to help with maintenance and...
Lately, yes. But the mentality until now was that one entity can take care of everything.
Yeah.
There was an attempt in the 1970s to paint the whole city.
Didn't occur,
that level of interest in the U.S. Mafia in Havana didn't happen, can you speculate on what would have happened to Cuba and Havana?
That's speculation. There wouldn't be the big boom that took place, but Havana would be, anyway, as splendor of city, the city it is. With less noise, less high-rise buildings and the like, with this kind of thing. Remember that this comes from the 18th century. It's one of the things I want to illustrate. When you come to Havana, you're surprised by the quality and the quantity of many houses you see around. It is because this qualification comes from the 18th century, from the beginning. And for that factor, I mentioned illustration. So our ancestors became very illustrated. They had a very sophisticated living standard. If you go to the museum of the city, you can see that. It's the furniture, the work, the silverware, the dinnerware, everything had to be the best. So it's not about the typical number of weeks. These people were very sophisticated. This house is an example. The owners left for Paris, and they ordered the construction of the house while they were there. And the color you see in the lobby, the plaster, is because the plaster was done with sand from the Nile. That is the original color. And the gazebo here is, these lamps were decorated, were designed by Brunella Lee. So they had another French landscaper decorating the garden, Forestier, and the like. So this is the kind of people who live here. Very sophisticated, very good taste. It's a one, two, many. So Havana will be a city like this and at a smaller scale, but the quality will be there. I would say that the Mafia brought many bad tastes. More bad taste than good taste. I mean, look at some interesting buildings like the here, Riviera Hotel, that was built by Mayor Lansky. But you know, they were interested in cheap hotels, not big hotels, because for them the question was, like in Las Vegas, the question is not the hotel, it's the gambling. The question is, you spend a night in Las Vegas for nothing, because the question is to spend the money at the casino. So it's a business. And that was a concept for many hotels in America. The hotel is not, doesn't need to be like Hotel Nacional, sophisticated. It's a hotel. Capri is an example here in Milano. It's a small hotel. And people don't understand. They say, this is a gambler's hotel. People don't care about more or less comfort. They spend all the day at the roulette.
Yes. Has there been any discussion of co-ops or condominiums as a vehicle for people to buy their own apartments and allow for a reserve that can be used for the maintenance of the complex?
This is what you said. Let's change. Okay? First, change in mindset. And people don't get it. I belong to the Union of Writers and Artists. It's a small group of architects, so we created a commission, City Culture Architecture. One of the things we were discussing is this. New problems, new ideas. There must be new ideas. I was at the previous Congress 5 years ago. I was concerned about how are we losing spaces in the city because of the lack of maintenance and deterioration. In 1959, Havana had 150,000 movie houses. In 2008, 50. Now, 39. And it continues. And they were just saying, look, we cannot continue have an aging population that needs to move to the center of the city, while they could be at home enjoying something that goes there, but there's no space. That's a school. See, the problem today is to grant land because, you know, for years the idea was that we need to industrialize agriculture. An industrial model of the big estate with a lot of machinery and a lot of pesticides and a lot of inputs that never worked. In the end, the small farmer, that I mean the small farmers that hold 40% of the land in Cuba, demonstrated that they produce more than 60% of the food with oxen, with simple methods. So that's why this is a very strategic move to grant land to people who are willing to work in the agriculture. 50% of the land is idle. In a country like this, let me tell you a very bittersweet anecdote to illustrate this. I would quote our president. He addressed the National Assembly 2 years ago and said, look, when the war in Vietnam ended, Cuba sent experts to Vietnam to show the Vietnamese how to grow coffee. Today, Vietnam is the second largest exporter of coffee in the world. And today, Cuba spends $40 million a year importing coffee from Vietnam. So you understand the nature of the problem. If you read in the newspaper that Cuba was importing coconut from Sri Lanka, guava from Brazil, papaya from Dominican Republic, eggs from the United States, the chicken, and the thing you can produce. Especially if you think about growing touristic industry, you need to bring more. To develop a more sustainable infrastructure.
So
lately, one of the good measures taken lately is this, to eliminate all the restrictions between the producer and the consumer. I mean, hotels and other touristic entities come by directly from the farmer. This is something new. And this is the only way to guarantee that there will be a continuous supply of fresh good quality.
I'm sorry, I'm missing something.
Yeah.
Why is 50% of the land not farmed?
Because what reason? You're retaining the house in the hands of the state, and then they wanted to turn the farmer into a worker, and if you have many options at the same time, you move. See, if you are going to be paid, let's say, 200 pesos for plowing the land, but I can be a truck driver or a waiter, or any other thing, but for the same money, I prefer the estates. So many people emigrated from the land. So now this is the idea now, how to incentivize people to migrate back. By the way, for your information, the only Latin American country in which you don't see misery in the country is Cuba. And the country, the more rich people in Cuba are the farmers. They are really rich.
Now?
Yes, really, really rich.
But why are the farmers rich?
Huh?
Why are the farmers rich?
Because they bring a lot of money. Think about it. Go to the food market, just one month so far, go there and see the prices. And you will understand. If the production is limited and there was a labyrinth, a bureaucratic labyrinth between you, the consumer, and the producer, people took advantage of that, the prices are very high, you make a lot of money. I know somebody, a friend of mine told me this, they went to sell a Chevrolet Silverado to a farmer. When the man saw the truck, he said, this must be mine. How much? You know how much paid the man for that? $90,000. And he was asked by my friend, hey buddy, how can you make so much money? He said, avocado, man, selling avocado.
Avocado.
sector, there's underground economy, it's dubious, but that's official. Mrs. Aspen. Are you there? Are you mesmerized by me?
Mahogany. Look at the doors. they never, for them, the best of the best, no matter from where, no matter how much. This is interesting. Museum of the Court of Art is a mansion, that a palace that belonged to a very wealthy family, and the museum was done using the belongings of the family. You have Chinese, Japanese, French. These secretary belong to Marie Antoinette, this and that. And what is very curious is that in the house, in every room, you have a fireplace.
Oh, like
because when they were inside, they wanted to have the feeling that they were not in Cuba. They hired French architects. They sent the wood to Europe to make there the windows.
Wow.
Not very short. She died young. She died short after. There, by the way, if you go to the cemetery, something else is that we're going to see.
I'm going to put these on YouTube.
It may have been in the most impressive mausoleum at the cemetery is her tomb. It's an art decorated by La Lady Insight.
What's the name?
Catalina Vasa.
Vasa?
Vasa.
And so then who inherited her children inherited the house?
No children.
Oh. Wow.
So it was a very short, but they enjoyed life very little. When they came back, they went to inaugurate the house. And they organized a reception. Nobody came.
Oh, that's unfair.
But they had a good idea.
They still ostracized.
They organized a second. With the invitation, they sent a dime.
Oh.
The house goes full.
They sent
Can you imagine if all these homes were, if they were constructed of this quality, were probably filled with the finest works of art and decoration? What happened to a lot of the things that filled all these grand homes in the Revolution?
Well, many of them, the owners left, and then these houses, many of these houses were changed. Something, institution, something like that. But we have perhaps a very large inventory of houses like this that are not having an appropriate use. And it's not easy to maintain it. I remember that years ago we complained about the columns at the entrance because somebody painted their columns in bright red.
Oh,
this house is a jewel. You need to keep it as more as possible the same it was built. Think about painting this. This is the original color of the sign of the night. Look at the head of the columns. It's some Egyptian with something. Very interesting. Central Park by the old city along the El Prado Avenue. Have you seen the El Prado Avenue? That resembles the Rambla in Barcelona.
Yeah.
Many of the houses along El Prado were built by the patricians. So when the car appears, no crashes, they move out of that. And see what happens. When you go to the, when you see the area along El Prado, all the houses were built sharing a bearing wall. But here in Vedado appears for the first time the segregation. And they segregate the garage and the servants' rooms from the house. And something interesting, the garage was something that could not be shown. So their garage is always in the back. And later, when there was more influence from the American style, and the swimming pool appeared, people moved to the front to have a house with a swimming pool. The only swimming pool in Vedado is next door at the house of the British ambassador. And it is indoor. It's an indoor swimming pool. So this is the kind of house you see around. There are many of these. But they live in the city, but isolated. So all these families had their connections. So for example, if there was a wedding, the party was done at the house. They had space. So what they used to do was to help each other, bring in butlers and maids and cooks to help serve. But they always, the party here, they needed, was a kind of mentality, everything in the house. how this neighborhood became great. Rock size is by the sea, it's a slope. This is right here, the sea, it's a terrace. And the neighborhood is far better. This design is the best design in the city. The first one to incorporate green spaces. Look at the old city, no green. Never. Central Havana, no green. Green was the first, for the first time incorporated after 1859 when they urbanized this area. Planters and these medians with trees and the like.